I would like to call the regular meeting of the Public Finance Authority, Water Utility Authority, Housing Successor, Successor Agency, and City Council to order. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora.
Here.
Councilmember Sarno.
Here.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Here.
Mayor Rodriguez.
Here. I would like to call upon Councilmember Mora to give the invocation.
Okay, where you may be, please stand and bow your heads. We direct our thoughts to you, Almighty God, and ask your blessings on everyone present. Please accept our gratitude for your goodness and generosity. Give us wisdom, courage, and foresight to accomplish the work before us. Amen.
Amen. I would like to call upon Councilmember Mora to lead the Pledge of Allegiance.
Place your hand over your heart. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance
to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, so public comments are now open. Anyone joining us through Zoom can use the raise hand function if you wish to make a public comment on any item on the agenda or not on the agenda. The city clerk will see if you have raised your hand through Zoom application. You will have 3 minutes to speak. City clerk, do we have any members of the public that wish to speak today?
Madam Mayor, we do. We have two speakers so far. First, we have Irma Withron.
Okay. Hi, Irma.
Hello, can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can hear you.
My apologies. My hand was raised up for the previous item. Would it still be appropriate to make comments now or just wait for the next study session?
You can make comments right now.
Okay. Just a comment related to the previous item on the agenda, the study session. My name's Irma Withron. I'm a resident of Santa Fe Springs. My comment as a resident and the previous item on the general plan and hearing from the business community is that I really thought it was great that the council members were asking and deliberating on the pros and cons and the economic impacts to the city of Santa Fe Springs based on the general plan changes. I appreciate the council taking a pause and really looking at the potential economic impact to the city of Santa Fe Springs, obviously as residents and being and hearing the capital improvement plan discussion a few weeks ago. It does concern me as a resident that Santa Fe Springs may not be able to keep up with the infrastructure that we need and that is required for the general plan changes. I do encourage the city council to review the business's impact analysis and even consider getting a peer review of another consultant to take a look at that impact analysis so that there can be an assessment of what we can take from there as a city and U.S. council members, the validity and the impacts to the economic impacts to the city, and make changes as necessary to not only balance the environmental justice issues of protecting the residents, but also protecting the economic vitality of the city of Santa Fe Springs. I think there needs to be a balance. And from what I heard from the business community, they made very, sensitive comments about not wanting to cause negative impact to the residents. I think we should bring them in as partners and see if there's a way to have a win-win where environmental justice issues are not ignored, but as proposed by the general plan, that we make changes as needed to protect us, but also protect the economic vitality of the city of Santa Fe Springs. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Irma. City Clerk?
Madam Mayor, next we have Stefan Wandel.
Thank you. Hi, Stefan. Stefan, are you there?
He might be on mute.
Okay, so maybe we can go to the next one and bring him back.
The next person will be Mo Manasian.
Hi, Madam Mayor.
Hi, Mo.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora and council members, I'm going to keep my comments short. I know we've heard a lot of the same, but the one thing I did want to touch on is my brother mentioned ad hoc committee, and I know Mayor Pro Tem Zamora mentioned he would be open to it, as did council members Trujillo and Sarno, and having greater discussion. Being that we're short on time to try to get something over the line, I know staff really does want to get the general plan along with the housing element approved at the same time. We've clearly gotten direction that it is completely not true that they have to be adopted together. Legally, it's not true. So I just want to make sure that when information is being shared with both city council and the general public, that we make sure the information there is completely factual. Wayne, I know you're shaking your head, but I mean, we have a legal opinion from our attorney's offices, and I'm sure you could probably get one from yours. We don't have to discuss it between you and I, but if we're looking for solutions, right? And I think that's the one thing I heard on the last study session, give us options, right? Industrial Council said, hey, if you need us to pitch in some money, we'll pitch in some money to buy some time so you don't have to lose out on the grant. That's one option. Second option, bifurcation. That's another option. Third option, put together an ad hoc committee. I know in the case of our balloon track property, which my brother mentioned, which is very unique, and I think Wayne would agree with that, we're basically bordered by the 605 freeway, two railroad tracks, and on top of that, the river. There's no residential access to our property whatsoever. We had a call where we actually had staff and Councilmember Sarno and now Mayor Pro Tem Zamora on the call. It would make sense if you have property owners who, in our case, we're not big landowners like Goodman, that potentially will lose their entire nest egg on a decision being made without having their voices heard. It doesn't seem like that's the right way to do this. We talk about environmental justice. Let's just talk about justice in general. Wouldn't it be fair to actually have an audience with several council members, present our case, show you a picture of the map of our property, the adjacencies, and let you guys then recommend with staff what is the right use of that property? That to me would seem fair, especially when you're making a decision in case of downzoning. Personally for us, that could basically be our entire family's nest egg in one shot on one quick decision. And as my brother mentioned earlier, in all the JPEG studies, not once was it ever recommended to downzone us, and our property is unique. And as my brother has worked in good faith, and as my late father had worked with the city, I mean, we obviously want to do something good in the city, but we also want to be treated fairly. And more importantly, have an audience to be heard. Madam Mayor, I sent you an email. I know my brother had sent Councilmember Sarno, and I've been trying to reach the rest of you. We just want an audience. An ad hoc committee would obviously allow us and others to have our voices heard. Thank you.
Thank you, Mo. Thank you.
Madam Mayor and Council, this is your city attorney. Just for clarification, staff has not represented that it would be illegal to separate the housing element from the general plan update. Staff has provided reasons why they are integrated and it would make sense to adopt them together, but at no point has staff stated that it's a legal requirement to do so. So I just wanted to provide that clarification.
Thank you. City Clerk, are there any more public comments?
Madam Mayor, that concludes our speakers. Oh, never mind. We just have had Stefan Wando raise his hand.
Okay, Stefan.
Yes, good evening. This is Stefan Wendell. I keep it short because it's getting late and you've heard from me before. I was a member of the GPAG Advisory Committee on the General Plan. Spent over a year participating in quite a few review sessions. And frankly, I'm really pleased with what's taking place the last 3-4 weeks. We've had, you know, with respect to the commercial land uses, which were never discussed at the GPAG, with the exception of maybe 3, 4, 5 properties at the most, not the 100+ properties that are being considered for downzoning. So I'm kind of really pleased that we're getting information. We're having conversation. I think it is productive. I think we're getting a lot more information from staff as to what they would consider, wouldn't consider, the details of this. Frankly, if we've had these conversations 3-4 months ago, a lot of these conversations today would probably be avoided. So I'm excited. I want to thank the council for encouraging these conversations to continue. It shows where I personally think we're making progress. And I look forward to continuing that. And, you know, if the concern really is around 14 businesses that are generating impacts and 3-4 really heavy industrial uses, that I don't think there's anybody in the community that says, hey, we need to have an asphalt batch plant in next to residential. I don't think you've heard this from anybody. And I sincerely doubt there were too many members of the community who would support that in the first place. So if the issue really is around, a dozen or you know, whatever number of properties or undesirable uses, and let's address those. And let's not make wholesale changes. And anyway, I'll keep it short because it's getting late. But thank you, and thank you again for the process, and thank you to the council for continuing to ask the right questions and encouraging the dialogue.
Thank you, Stefan. City Clerk, are there any more comments?
Madam Mayor, I don't see any further public comments.
Good. Okay, I will now close public comments and move on to the next item. Item number 6, Public Financing Authority Agenda. We have 2 consent items. Is there a motion for the approval of the items 6A and 6B?
I'll move 6A and 6B. Juanita.
Second, John.
Okay, we have a motion by Councilmember Trujillo and second by Councilmember Mora. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora. Councilmember Mora, you're on mute.
Yeah, aye.
Councilmember Sarno.
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to item number 7, Water Utility Authority Agenda. We have 3 consent items. Is there a motion for the approval of items number 7A through 7C?
I'll move, John.
Second, Joangel.
Okay, we have a motion by Councilmember Mora and a second by Mayor Pro Tem Zamora. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora.
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno.
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item number 8, Housing Successor Agenda. We have 1 consent item. Is there a motion for the approval of item number 8?
I'll move.
I'm sorry, who said that?
Jay.
Thank you, Jay.
Second, Juanita.
Okay, so we have a motion by Councilmember Sarno and second by Mayor Pro Tem Zamora. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora.
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno.
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item number nine, successor agenda. Agency agenda, we have 2 consent items. Is there a motion for the approval of item number 9A and 9B?
I'll move, John.
I'll second, Jay.
We have a motion by Councilmember John and second by Councilmember Sarno. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora.
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno.
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item number 10, City Council Agenda. We have 7 consent items. Is there a motion for the approval of the City Council Consent Agenda?
I'll move, Juanita. I'll set all items.
Second, Joangel.
Okay, we have a motion by Juanita and second by Joangel. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora?
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno?
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora?
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Okay, public hearing item number 11, consideration of an appeal of development plan approval case number 980 and related environmental documents. Is there a motion to continue item number 11 to the meeting of Tuesday, March 1st, 2022?
I'll move, Joe.
I'll second, Jay.
Okay, we have a motion by Joe Angel and second by Jay. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora?
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno?
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora?
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item number 12, ordinance number 1120, amending City Code Chapter 74, Section 1, and revising certain prima facie speed limits. I would like to call on Director of Public Works, Noe Negrete.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you.
Council, I got a presentation here for you, and don't be scared off by all the Latin words there. All we're trying to do is reset to make sure that our speed limits that are signed on our streets, that they're correct. You go next slide, please, Jeff. So we are obligated to do an engineering and traffic survey every 5 years by law. Our last one we did was in 2016. First let me start off by saying you did receive a report, a revised report today. So we do apologize for that. We did see some segments that were incorrect and we want to make sure that they're accurate. So therefore the report that was given to you was revised. And I can tell you where those are at as we get to those areas. So there's 115 street segments that were analyzed as part of the study. When you're looking at them, we review the accident history, the existing field conditions, as well as we perform a 24-hour traffic counts. Next slide, please. So why are we doing this? Basically, we have to do this because it gives our law enforcement legal backing to enforce speeding tickets. Okay, that's the first thing. Number two is by doing this, we go out and investigate, examine those roadways and make sure that those posted speed limits are still applicable and reasonable to be enforced. This survey, should you approve it, will be a 2-year extension. So it'll take us to January of 2024. There are some options to extend it, but we can deal with that in 2024. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay, go back one. Actually, you can stay there. You can stay there, Jeff. That's fine. You stay there. So after analyzing all the 115 segments, there was 14 segments that came back with some anomalies and disparities, in particular on the traffic counts. And as you can imagine, doing this during COVID, some of the counts were significantly different than they were in 2016. So we asked the consultant to go back and look at these 14 segments and make sure that they were posted correctly. I'm not going to read all those numbers to you. That just tells you one of the pages of the report. Go ahead and go to the next slide now, Jeff. So, go back. I think we skipped the other one. The good news is 110 of the 115 segments had no change in the speed limit zone. That's the good news. There were 5, though, that do require a change. In the staff report, we had 7 identified, Meyer Road and from Shoemaker to the Easterly City Limit, and Oranday Road from Mondin to Florence was identified, and those are identified incorrectly. Those are going to remain the same. So we have 4 segments that are going to change. We're recommending that they increase by 5 miles an hour. And we also have one new street segment where we're actually going to post a new speed limit sign. So let me tell you where those are. Go ahead, Jeff. I think it's two slides. Next, there you go. So I'll walk you through each of the 4. Again, this is based on the traffic counts and the speed survey that was conducted. So the first segment is on Freeway Drive from Excelsior to Alondra Boulevard. So where that is, Freeway Drive in Alondra is literally right in front of the swap meet. And if you take that road all the way around, it'll take you to Carmenita's truck. That's Freeway Drive. So that segment there is currently signed as 30 miles an hour. And as you can imagine, that when that initial one was done in 2016, this area was in construction. So you can see the disparity from 30 miles to 40 miles an hour now that the construction is over. The second segment is Hathaway Drive or Old Devedos Place. And that is around Heritage Park on the backside, going from Florence to Mora Drive. And that is being recommended to go from 30 to 35 miles an hour. The third segment is on Pioneer Boulevard. So as you're coming into the city from Los Nietos South, and this is where it ties into at Orenday Road, just south of Charlesworth. Not surprising, it's going from 35 to 40. This is a very active area of enforcement. You know, when Dino does give his updates on tickets given, this is one of the areas that the most tickets are given out is on this segment. The last area is on Shoemaker Avenue between Lakeland and Telegraph. And it's going from 40 to 45 miles an hour. And then the one new piece that we're establishing is a very small segment called Iseli Road. It's from Stage Road to Rosecrans. And it currently does not have any kind of speed limit established. Most likely because it was on the boundary for so many years, a very small industrial street, and we're recommending to set that at 25 miles an hour. And just, I have Tom Lopez, our traffic engineer on the line, if you have any detailed questions, but how this is set, it's based on the 85th percentile, so 85% of people of how fast they drive, and then we're able to adjust 5 miles up or 5 miles down. And all of these that you see, we're actually adjusting the 85th percentile 5 miles down, 5 miles lower. Next slide. So here's where you see those 14 segments that we looked at. On the right-hand side, you see where it says change. Those are the segments that the change is proposed to increase. So Freeway Drive, as you can see, it tells you the segment from Excelsior to Alondra. Existing speed limit was 30 miles an hour. 85th percentile was 45 miles an hour. The recommendation is to go to 40 miles an hour. And you can see that for the other three segments as well, for the Hathaway piece, the Pioneer piece, and the Shoemaker piece. And then Iseli is four down, and it has under existing NP, and that refers to it's not posted currently. And that's what we're recommending, the 25 mile per hour sign.
I don't know if we're doing questions at the end or not, but if I'm understanding right,
your preference, go ahead.
If we are like the Pioneer Boulevard, we're increasing it because people are driving faster.
Correct.
But in that residential, we are more or less conforming to the speeders. So it's okay to speed because we're just going to conform to what they're speeding, even though it's an industrial area. I mean, a residential area. So, I mean, because we're giving a lot of speeding tickets there because they're all going about 40 miles an hour. So we're going to increase it so they don't get speeding tickets.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Jeff, if you can make Tom a panelist there. And while you're making Tom a panelist, if Dino wants to answer that, this is more of a law enforcement issue than
So I would say that we're giving a variety of tickets. Most of the tickets I think that we're giving are for improper maneuvers, violations of signs, for example, the stop signs, turns where they're not supposed to make turns. In order for you to catch someone speeding, it's not to say that we're not getting people that are speeding, but they're not all speeding tickets. In order to get someone that's speeding, because we have this issue that we just mentioned, is that a police vehicle now needs to pace vehicle that might be speeding. And so you could issue tickets, but you'd have to pace the vehicle. And that's what's happening now. But we have a variety of types of violations that are occurring. Some of them are speeding.
Tom, are you there? Do you want to give a brief synopsis of how we set speed limits, answering Council Member Trujillo's question? To further expound, I'm sure you're asking if they all drove 100 miles an hour, then would we set the speed limit at 100 miles an hour? I'm assuming that's what your question is, correct?
It's logic. It's like if you're speeding, so we have to go faster. So I don't see the logic of a residential area for us to go faster because they're doing it. It's kind of like, I don't know if it makes sense to others, but to me.
Let me see if Tom can answer how we set the speed limits. Tom, okay. Are you there?
Yes, Council Member Trujillo, good evening. The rules and regulations for setting speed limits are pretty rigid. They're set in the California Vehicle Code. And this speeding is an epidemic everywhere because you have to post at or near the 85th percentile, which is called the critical speed. Once you deviate from that more than 5 miles an hour, you can't use radar. And that, like Dino said, the police have to pace them. Or if they know a predetermined distance, they'll time it and say, it takes 10 seconds to drive that distance. This guy made it in 2 seconds. So he's obviously speeding. So the only streets that are automatically 25 miles an hour are pure residential streets, which are less than a quarter mile in length of uninterrupted length. They're 40 foot wide or less, one lane each direction. Other than that, all other streets have to be surveyed and assigned a speed limit.
So you are correct. So it is based on 85th percentile. So 85% of people, whatever speed they drive, it has to be set within 5 miles of that speed that they are driving. And that's basically how the law works. But I think intuitively you're saying you don't want to encourage people to speed. That is correct, especially in a residential area. However, if we want to give a speeding ticket in that area, we would have to increase the speed to 40 miles an hour on Pioneer.
The long way around that, Councilwoman, you're correct. It's going with the higher speeders where, even though we may think personally that's too high of a speed, we can't enforce it unless we increase that speed through the state law. So I think we're encouraging speeding, but what's happening there is speeding, and that's what it's set at. So it is counterintuitive what we're trying to accomplish, but to actually enforce it, we have to go along with that by state law.
So I remember this back in 16 when they wanted us to increase the speed in front of the high school in Lakeview, and we decided not to increase that because of the children that are present. It's 25, and I think they were recommending to do 45 in that on the stretch between Telegraph to Florence on Oranday Road. I remember that was something that came up back then. So I don't know. Now it looks like people have slowed down, but because when children are present in front of the high school and the kid and the elementary school, I know that we made a big stink about increasing the speed in front of the schools. So.
Yeah, just to clarify, the stretch on Oranday, basically from Pioneer all the way to Florence, is staying at 35.
Yes.
Per the study.
It looks like they slowed down. That's what I'm saying. Because I think when we did the study in 16, it was 45 they were recommending.
Yeah. They did the study, if I remember right, they did the study like when it was summer during vacation when we had no school, so that's why the cars are already going. Yeah.
And I believe the one caution when you don't go with the study is you could, if someone fights a ticket, they can win, and if someone sues you, you can lose. So there is, if you go against that study, that's what can happen.
Yeah. Lastly, the last slide whenever they get there is just we did an overall cleanup from the 2016 study to today. In the ordinance, you see like 22 or 23 segments listed on there, not just the five we're talking about. It's because we did catch a lot of inaccuracies, misspellings, typos in there. So we're cleaning it up so that when we do submit the 2022 survey, that it is correct.
I thought, I don't know where I read it, but I thought I heard something that the state was turning to the cities to determine the speed limits instead of following what the state in their city is. I don't know if that is.
No, we've always had the ability to determine the speed limits in our city. Every locale, every municipality has that authority.
Okay.
Unless you're on a state highway, then, or you're on a freeway, then the state governs.
Sounds good.
That concludes the presentation. I'm happy to answer any more questions that you have.
Yeah, just one comment. Like, you know, I had mentioned to you earlier, Noe, it looks like, you know, that segment of Pioneer is the only segment that's residential. Everything else, the 5 miles an hour increase, you know, that appears to be okay. But it just says what mentioned before, it's a little, I guess it's because there's more speeders. Now we'd have the ability to actually catch more speeders if we did increase it. But this is going to go on to the year 2024, and then we can revisit this. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And so could we keep a close eye on, you know, this particular stretch by increasing 5 miles an hour, regardless of catching speeders? But, you know, my concern is, you know, it is a residential area, and I'm up and down the street quite a bit. There's people running across the street all the time. And if they're going to be, you know, going to 40 miles an hour right before they get to Charlesworth and then decrease it to 30 and vice versa. You know, I mean, I'm just, it's just a safety concern that I had in mind, but this is one of these things that I guess has to be done because of the state. Let's keep a close eye on any potential hazards that may occur. And if we have to, you know, give it a 2-year span, we could change this back, correct?
Yeah, if the survey results back lower, we can change it back.
Just
the 85th percentile, just so you know, was actually 44 miles an hour. So actually 45 is closer, but we have the authority to round down as long as we're within 5 miles. So that's why we're going to 40, not the 45, because we're well aware of where this area is in a residential area. Mm-hmm. And we do want to keep the speeding down as best possible, but still comply with the law.
Okay.
Well, I know in the past, you know, Councilman Zamora had requested a stop sign at Whiteland, and maybe that's a way to keep, you know, we can increase the speed or slow it down by adding a stop sign at Whiteland, especially for the kids in the residential area. So that might be something that we need to do now more than ever, because instead of increasing the speed limit, we can then keep it to what it is and add a stop sign.
And we can take this offline, but again, we are governed by the MUTCD to make sure whenever we put it in a device, it's warranted. And unfortunately, that location has not been warranted, but we can follow up with that offline for the discussion.
No problem. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Noe. Thank you for the presentation. Okay, moving right along. Is there a motion for the approval of item number 12?
I'll move, Juanita.
I'll second, Jay.
Okay, we have a motion by Juanita and second by Jay. I would like to call on the city attorney to read the title of ordinance number 1120.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the council. Ordinance number 1120 is an urgency ordinance of the city of Santa Fe Springs, amending the city code chapter 74, section 1, and revising certain prima facie speed limits. And just for the record, this is the revised ordinance that accompanied the revised staff report that was emailed to you this afternoon.
Thank you. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora?
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno?
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora?
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez?
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. A new business. Item number 13, appointments to council committees. I would like to call on the city clerk.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Every year after the mayor and mayor pro tem or reorganization, the city council has an opportunity to make changes to the liaisons assigned to each advisory committee, the council subcommittee list, and the external agency appointments. We recommend for each one of you to review each list and make recommended changes. That concludes my presentation.
Thank you. Okay, so we will begin with the liaisons for each advisory committee. So I'm going to go down the list with the title of the advisory committee and the name of the council member appointed to the committee. So the first one is the Beautification and Historical Committee. I'd like to appoint Juanita for that committee.
What time is that? I don't know if I'll be able
to work. It's 9:30 in the morning, fourth Wednesday.
Yeah, 9:30. I can't. Yeah, that's, I work during the day. That's, that one I cannot be. I could try to be a secondary, but I can't be the main one on that one.
Okay, so you prefer an evening?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I usually do the evening ones.
Okay.
Just real quick, are we going over all of them, or are we changing each one of them? Or?
There's one that we're not going over. City Clerk, which one are we not going over?
Madam Mayor, that would be your decision of which one you would like to
make changes. Oh, no, there was one that about the committees that we've already, they still have one more year left.
Oh, the list that we're not reviewing today is the advisory, the appointments to the advisory committee, such as the members. That's the list that we're not reviewing today.
We're not doing that.
Their term continues until the end of this year.
Right. Okay. So let's see. Okay. Well, the other ones that are in the evening are the Sister City. Would you like to do that one?
My thing is just because I know why we have our list and stuff. Are we changing everybody off it, or are we just, are we?
We can leave everybody the same on the advisory committee, but if everybody's okay with that, but you're not on here, you don't have any, I would like to see at least you on one of them, and you're not on any of them.
Oh, no, that's fine. I've been on the Sister City committee before. I'm totally okay with that.
Okay.
I just didn't want to take somebody off of it who was on it, who didn't want it. That's why.
Okay, let's back up. John, did you want to stay on the Sister City committee and have Juanita as an alternate?
Either one, you know, I'm okay. Like her. Monday, Wednesday, Fridays, I work. So
if you want, I could take it and then you could be the alternate if you want to do that.
Yeah, that'll work.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Perfectly fine.
Yep.
Okay. And so
Sister City, yeah.
Education and Historical Committee, who would like to take that? That's at 9:30, fourth Wednesday. Jay, you were on that before. Did you want to continue?
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Okay, so we're going to just keep everybody as is on the advisory committees.
I got a question, Madam Mayor.
Yes.
A lot of these committees are not active as of right now. That's are some, because like our Sister City, are they going to stay going? You know, I think we have to ask those committee members if these committees are going to be continuous with members. Because I know you guys, when I had just left, that you guys had combined a lot of committees because they didn't have enough members in them. So
okay, let's just go down the list. Is the Beautification and Historical Committee, is that one active right now, Jay?
I don't know.
Okay, so well, you're on it. So if you don't know,
it's not active. No.
Okay, so we'll work on that. But your name is right there, so that you can stay on there. Family and Human Services, I'll go ahead and stay on that one. And they're actually going to start tomorrow via Zoom. I'll stay on that one. Heritage Arts Advisory Committee, I'll go ahead and stay on that one, and they are active. Parks and Rec Advisory Committee, John, are they active right now?
Yes, we're going to Zoom. Okay.
You can stay on that one.
Yeah.
And the Senior Advisory Committee, Jay, are they active right now?
They are not.
Okay. Well, it seems to be only yours. What's going on?
Nobody wants to have a meeting.
Madam Mayor, if I may.
Yes.
So it would be appropriate to make appointments or make any suggested changes to each one of them. If there's any combination of any of these advisory committees in the future, we will notify all the council of these changes. But for now, even if they have not met recently, it would be best to still make those appointments just in case they do decide to proceed with the meeting within the next few months.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Madam Mayor, this is Maricela Valderas. Maricela. And I wanted to say that all of our advisory committees, they reconvened this month, and they all reconvened via Zoom. And they'll be conducting these meetings through March through via Zoom, and then reconvene in April.
Okay. Thank you. Perfect. See, there you go, Jay.
There you go. I get to have a meeting now. Good.
Okay. Moving right along. Sister City Committee, we got... let me make sure this is right. Juanita, you're going to be the liaison, and John's going to be the alternate.
Okay. Yes.
And the Youth Leadership Committee, Mayor Pro Tem Zamora will continue that.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, next we will have our council subcommittees. I'm going to go down the list with the title of the council subcommittee and the name of the council member. Okay, so we have Audit Finance Committee, Juanita and alternate John Mora. Billboards, we have Jay Sarno and Juanita Trujillo. Budget, events, and programs, we have Zamora, Mora, and Sarno. So there's three of you. So we'll just leave it the same.
It is
the budget, events, and programs. Okay. Yes. Okay. And then the next one is budget, revenue, and fees. That would be Rodriguez and Zamora. Capital improvement projects. That would be myself and John Mora. Economic development strategy, that would be myself and Mayor Pro Tem Zamora. General plan, that would be Mayor Pro Tem Zamora and Councilmember Sarno. Long-term housing plan, that would be Councilmember Mora and Councilmember Sarno. And the Whittier PD contract, that would be myself and Mayor Pro Tem Zamora. Okay, and last, we have the external council committees, which are appointments of council to represent outside agencies. Okay, so moving right along, we have California Contract Cities Association, Juanita. Chamber Youth Enrichment Fund Board, myself. The Mayor City Selection Committee, League of Cal Cities, it says that the mayor has to take that position. Gateway Cities Council of Governments, Zamora. Alternate is Trujillo. I'm just gonna go by the last names because that's what it says right here, just to make it easier. The 91-605-405 Committee Subcommittees of COG, Juanita. Hispanic Outreach Task Force, Juanita. The I-5 Consortium Policy Board, we have John, and the alternate is Zamora. The Joint Powers Insurance Authority, we have Sarno. The LA CATA, we have myself. The League of California Cities, we have Juanita with an alternate of Sarno. The Metropolitan Little League, we have myself. The Sanitation District is the mayor, position, so myself. We have the Santa Fe High School Education Foundation, myself. We have the Santa Fe Springs South Whittier Education Center Advisory Committee, President's Advisory Committee, Juanita. Alternate is myself. SASPA, we have John Mora. Alternate is myself. We have SIACA. That is Mayor Pro Tem Zamora. Alternate is Council Member Trujillo. Southwest Water Coalition Board, we have John Mora. Southern California Association of Governments, we have Juanita. The Vector Control, we have Joe Angel Zamora. And the Washington Boulevard Coalition of the Gold Line Extension, we have John Mora. And the non-council appointed city committees. We have
the Madam Holiday- Mayor, if I may, sorry, I'm trying to keep up with the changes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes. For the Southeast Water Coalition Board, who would you have as the delegate and alternate?
Oh, myself. I'll go ahead.
Okay. Okay. So the same. So we'll remain the same for that one.
No, no, it's John Mora. He'll John be Mora. Okay. The Southwest Water Coalition.
And for the alternate?
Does anybody want to be an alternate for the Water Coalition? It'll be myself. Okay. Yeah.
And I'm sorry, and for the Southern California Association of Governments?
That's Juanita.
Yeah. Okay, so remains the same.
Yes.
Okay, I apologize for that. Thank you. Oh,
no, that's okay, of course.
So I'm no longer, so I just want to double check. So I'm no longer on SIACA then, correct?
You're the alternate.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so the non-council appointed city committees is a holiday home decorating contest, SARNO, Friends of the Library Board of Directors, Zamora, the Safe Neighborhood Team, myself, alternate is Juanita. The scholarship interview panel is the Mora, is John Mora. The Sandoval is Zamora, and the Sharp is myself.
Madam Mayor, it's Travis. Can I get a clarification on the Audit and Finance Committee? I believe you mentioned one council member with an alternate, but there we should have two members.
The Audit Finance Committee is Juanita and John Mora.
And then on the budget committees, we have the Events and Programs and then the Revenues and Fees. I'm not sure why we show three on there. Typically between those two committees, we'll have the four council members who are not the mayor, with the mayor not being on one of those committees, who would meet with staff individually. So I'm not sure, could we clarify that one?
The budget, events, and programs? Is that what you're talking about?
Correct, both that one and the revenue and fees, the next one.
Okay, yeah, it said in the past, it said budget, events, and programs, Zamora, Mora, and Sarno. So you only need two?
Correct.
Okay, we'll take Sarno off. And then the budget, revenue, and fees, that was myself and Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
See, Mayor Pro Tem Zamora is on the other committee. And
I see, okay. Then we'll put Sarno.
And we would generally meet with you individually. So perhaps we would have a council member Trujillo and okay. Council member Sarno on the revenues and fees.
Yes, that's good. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. And let's see. Okay, now that we complete our committees, we will move on to item number 14. Item number 14, authorize the purchase of Microsoft Office software licenses from Gov Connections Incorporated. I would like to call on Director of Finance, Travis Hickey.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and members of the council. Just quickly on this item, this was an upgrade of the Microsoft Office software that's utilized on all of the computers within the city. The upgrade was planned as we've been aware that Microsoft will no longer be supporting our current version, which is the Office 2013. We had budgeted $60,000 as part of the fiscal year 21-22 budget. As we looked into the upgrade, we found both that the individual licenses and the number of licenses that we were going to need had increased. And so our overall budget is going to be more than $60,000, but it will take some time to implement this upgrade. And so what we're asking for at this point is an approval for kind of the first round of licenses that we can buy within that $60,000 budget. That'd be 145 licenses at a total of just over $59,000. And then either through the mid-year or the next year's budget, we would come back with the remainder of the upgrade. And so that's it. I'm happy to take any questions.
Okay. And is there a motion for the approval of item number 14?
I'll move, John.
Second, Joe Angel.
Okay, we have a motion by John and second by Joe Angel. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Mora.
Aye.
Councilmember Sarno.
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item number 15, adopt resolution number 9571, approving changes to the salary schedule effective January 3rd, 2022. I would like to call on Director of Finance, Travis Hickey.
Hi, this again is just one slight change to our salary schedule that's being proposed. This is for the city electrician position. The proposal is to move it from class 149 to class 158. To make it more competitive with other agencies and discourage turnover. There is a resolution that's associated with it because all changes to the salary schedule must happen through resolution. And so we had intended to do this change last meeting with the council reorganization. We held off on this item, but that's why we are asking for it to be retroactive to January 3rd. Again, happy to take any questions.
Okay, is there a motion for the approval of item number 15?
I'll move, Juanita.
Second, John.
Okay, we have a motion by Juanita and second by John. City Clerk, roll call, please.
Councilmember Sarno. I'm sorry, Councilmember Mora.
Aye.
I apologize. Councilmember Sarno.
Aye.
Councilmember Trujillo.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Zamora.
Aye.
Mayor Rodriguez.
Aye.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item number 16, presentations, the Planning Department's fourth annual Planning Month photo contest winners. I would like to call upon Director of Planning, Wayne Morrell.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Jeff, could you, it's already there. Okay, in 2021, the Planning Department hosted the fourth annual National Community Planning Month photo contest. It ran from October the 1st to the 31st. This time we did something differently from before. We actually had three categories: youths, teens, and adult. And again, this is something that we've never done before, but we thought maybe we would get more submittals if we did it in this manner. Next slide, please, Jeff. Under the youth category, the winner was Angeli Soto, and that's the photo that was selected. And the winners were selected by the Planning Commission. So at a prior Planning Commission meeting, they were shown all of the photos, and they selected the winners from each category. Next, please. The teen winner was Ruby Soto, and this was her presentation, her photo. Next slide, please, Jeff. And the adult winner was Janice Kwibuyen, and this was her winning photo. We hope to continue this each year, and next year we hope that maybe with the help of council and others, we can get more people to participate, because it really works great when you have a lot of photos that's submitted. So hopefully next year council can get involved and get the word out there so that we could get more people to participate. And so a special thanks goes out to the Planning Commission for selecting the adult winner category. The winner of each category will receive a feature in an upcoming City Quarterly and each winner will receive $100 that's been donated by myself and Louis Colasso. So we have a joke. No general fund money has been spent on the prize. So I do not know if there are, Jeff, for the names that I mentioned, are any of those individuals in the audience as attendees? And if they do, could they please raise their hand? It doesn't appear that there is anyone. So that is essentially the I thought I saw Janice raise her hand. Yes, Jeff, could you let Janice just give a quick speech, please, a quick comment? Janice, you may say something if you wish.
Hi there, this is Janice. I just wanted to say thank you for putting this on. It's just a nice way to sort of feature our city and sort of look around and see what beauty is out there. So thanks, everyone.
Yes, so Janice, if you please contact either myself or any of my staff so that you can get your $100.
Great, thank you.
And again, it had to be something about the city, a place that you love, that just highlighting the city itself. We thought this would be a good way to highlight the city because we do have some very interesting buildings, places, et cetera, in the city, scenery that certainly should be highlighted. Thank you. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Wayne. Thank you for those beautiful pictures as well.
Okay. You're welcome.
I would like to call upon our city manager, Ray Cruz.
Yes, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. I just wanted to go back to our earlier meeting, our study session on the general plan. And I did appreciate Stefan Modell from Thrifty Oil's comments that although we've had some bumps on the road, he did think we're making progress. And I do also. And I think a way that we're going to move forward is to, ad hoc would be difficult to try to get only two members to talk, speak for all of you. We're going to have a study session. But what we did working with the industry group on the truck moratorium / truck tax is that we took questions from them and answered them in a fall meeting. So what I want to do is all those letters that were sent, the questions that we're going to ask of the industry group, Wayne's already been in contact with some of the members between our last meeting and where we're at this point, and then try to get a meeting as quickly as possible, maybe even as early as end of this week, if we can. But we're going to have a meeting where we're going to have some productive dialogue where you can ask questions, but we'll have questions answered directly from the letters and from direct questions coming from the industry. And so in questions from you, council, we're going to ask you questions. There are things that you still haven't heard directly from staff or the industry group. So we're going to try to field all those, have them ready, answered, and then have that dialogue through a study session as soon as possible. So I just wanted to report that out to you at this point. Secondly, I wanted to let you know COVID is kind of running along through our organization. We've been impacted significantly, and that's why we're on shifts of our schedule, our employees. We'll be working Monday, Wednesday, Tuesday, Thursday, and every other Friday on shifts with our employees. But the good news is that all of our operations are open. There's not one facility that's closed. However, if we get a run on COVID positives with the Omicron variant, we may have to close things. But right now, we are still open, and we'll keep council apprised of all of that. And at this point, I'd like to bring up Director of Public Works, Noe Negrete. Thank you.
Be happy to not have no report, Madam Mayor.
All right, we'll then go up to Wayne Morrell, Director of Planning.
Yes, Honorable Madam Mayor, I have no report tonight. Thank you.
We got some quiet guys tonight, so we'll jump to Dino Torres, Director of Police Services.
I'll give my report. Good evening, City Council. Next slide, please. Next slide. So on December 20th, our department hosted its first Cookies with Santa event at the Police Services Center. So approximately 150 families showed up to take a picture with Santa and police officers. On the slides, you can see a few snapshots of staff, Santa, and families that attended. We appreciate everyone who came out and look forward to this year's event. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Could bring up Chief Hayward next.
Hi, good evening, Madam Mayor and Council. Just confirming you can hear me.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we can hear you. Thank you.
Good evening. It's been 42 days since I've given a report on COVID statistics, and so I'll just give a one slide real quick report for the city. Over the last 42 days in the county of Los Angeles, we went from a COVID positivity of rate of 1.43%, which was already alarming at that time. Today, our COVID positivity rate within the county is at 20.85%, which is 14 times higher in that period of time. Not quite as proportionally increasing, and which is a good sign, is that the hospital average rate went from about 600 to a little over 4,500, which is about 7.5 times that average. If you look on the right, you see the positivity rate. Hopefully we're starting to hit that peak and gonna start declining here soon. What's that mean for the city of Santa Fe Springs over the last 42 days? Over 42 days, we've had an increase in 1,657 individuals within the city. But again, positive on that is we've had no increase in deaths. If we could go to the next slide. As you may know, Santa Fe Springs is hosting a FEMA COVID testing mega site at 12800 Imperial Highway, better known as the Transportation Center off of Imperial at the BNSF train tracks just east of Bloomfield. They are operating daily from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. They're originally starting with about 1,000 people per day, but predicted to be able to handle 6,000 per day. I personally went over there day one to see what the process was, and it's actually very, very smooth. One of our fire department employees actually utilized it the other day and said it was very smooth, very quick, and she had results within about 30 hours or so. Again, this is free to all. If you look at the lower bottom, you can register to basically get a QR code prior to entering the facility, but you don't have to have that to enter the facility. When you do, they'll receive you, they'll put you in a particular parking spot, and then you do the registration, which takes about 5 minutes on your phone, and then you proceed through the line, do your test, and you get your results within 24 to 36 hours later. So again, this is at 12800 Imperial Highway. To enter the facility, you basically travel east on Imperial Highway and you make a right-hand turn into the facility. There is no left-hand turn in there. So when you cross Bloomfield, you make a right-hand turn in the parking lot, and they seem to be expediting people pretty well. So I'm pretty impressed on this. And so if you have an opportunity or you have concerns, definitely this is a place to take a look at. And finally, last slide.
Hey, Chief, can I interrupt you for a second?
Yes, sir.
I don't believe it's a FEMA site. I believe it City of Norwalk is sponsoring with the cooperation of the City of Santa Fe Springs. And there's a third party vendor that is actually administering the testing through federal funding. So I just wanted to make that one clear.
Yeah, and that is correct. I just, I should have made that clarification. Yes, definitely within the city, Norwalk, and a third party. One of the things that was noted on the third party vendor is about 50% of the people that they're using are veterans. And so that's a real positive thing, but ultimately it it does start with federal funding. And so that's why I referred to FEMA at the beginning. So sorry about that. Lastly, I just wanted to touch on, everybody probably knows that a firefighter from LA County who was there for 2 years, Jonathan Flagler, was fighting a house fire in Rancho Palos Verdes, lost his life on January 6th fighting that fire. He was 2 years with Los Angeles County. He was 19 years with the city of Vernon before Vernon was taken over with LA County. So I wanted to just point out really quickly that one of our firefighters was hired with him, who's been with us for 14 years. Vernon was part of Operational Area E, and Firefighter Flagler was a hazmat specialist with Vernon, and we had responded on several calls together. And so this individual actually impacted Santa Fe Springs multiple times, as we did with them in Vernon. So I just wanted to point out his dedication to his profession, dedication to his family, and the fire service. His services are at 10 o'clock this Friday at Cottonwood Church, which is in Los Alamitos. It's about 6 miles south of Carmenita from Fire Station 3. So with that, I just wanted to pay tribute to Firefighter Flagler and his family and just point out his contributions to not only fire service, but the city of Santa Fe Springs. And with that, that ends my report.
Thank you, Chief. Now I'd like to bring up Director of Finance, Travis Hickey.
Good evening again. Just one quick item to report along the COVID lines, in particular with the impact on our city employees. This is looking back to December and January. January to date, not including some of the intakes that we're still continuing to do at this hour. But as of this morning, we're looking at 46 positive cases amongst employees, along with 77 additional employees who were required to quarantine due to exposures. There were a number of additional people who were exposed but were not subject to quarantine due to their booster vaccination status. And so this has just put a great demand and stress on our HR staff, and they're just working exceptionally hard to keep up with this. And so we appreciate the work that they're doing. These figures also don't reflect the many, many number of calls dealing with people who have symptoms that turn out to not be COVID-related cases. But so it's just an incredibly difficult time that they're going through right now. You know, we're keeping an eye on it. I'm hoping to see some decline amongst our employees here soon. But at least as of today, we haven't seen that yet. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Travis. Now I'd like to bring up Director of Community Services, Maricela Banderas.
Thank you, Ray. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. The holidays were quite busy for us in community services. Our staff worked really hard, and they did an excellent job planning all of the holiday events for our community. I'd like to take a moment just to give you a brief wrap up of some of these events. Wanted to start off with our home decorating contest. It featured 27 entries this year. It was great to see the community to get into the holiday spirit. We had 12 lucky winners, and they were presented with yard signs. And they're also going to be invited to attend a future council meeting for a formal presentation for their efforts. Next slide. On Sunday, December the 19th, the Parks and Recreation Division, they hosted a special one-day camp called Grinchmas. The staff led the activities, they provided snacks, and they viewed the 1966 animated classic, How the Grinch Stole Christmas. The event also provided the parents and the caregivers an opportunity to do some last minute shopping. We had 41 participants that registered for this activity. Next, on Saturday, December the 18th, the Family and Human Services Division hosted its annual Neighborly Elf Christmas Basket Program at the Gus Velasco Neighborhood Center. The program consisted of a modified in-person event. The families received their food basket, toys, and gift cards, and they had an opportunity to take a photo with Santa and Mrs. Claus. We had a total of 144 families and seniors who participated in this event. Here's a short video recapping the event. Our Santa Float program, now in its 41st year, the Santa Float program made its return to traditional form this year. During the 2-week period, the float made 24 stops throughout the city and 15 home visits. It was great to see all the connections and the interactions with the community and all the kids and their smiling faces as they waved to Santa. During the second night of the stops, the float got a special visit from one of our pioneers of the Santa Float. Parks and Rec Advisory Committee member and Planning Commissioner Ken Arnold and his family. It was great to see him out with the community. There's a lot of planning and collaboration that goes on to plan this program. The Community Services Department wants to thank Public Works and Police Services employees for their continued commitment to making this program a great success. We also want to thank our City Council members for your support of this longstanding program. And we especially want to thank all of the volunteers that dedicated cold and sometimes rainy nights to bring holiday cheer to our community. A special recognition dinner is going to be scheduled sometime in the end of February. Here's a recap of the video of that program.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Vixen and Blixen and all his reindeers pulling on the reins. Bells are ringing, children singing, all is merry and bright. So hang your stockings and say your prayers, cause Santa Claus comes tonight. Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. He's got a bag that's filled with toys for boys and girls again. Hear those sleigh bells jingle, jangle, oh, what a beautiful sight. So jump in bed and cover your head, cause Santa Claus comes tonight. Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. He doesn't care if you're rich or poor, he loves you just the same. Santa Claus knows we're all God's children, that makes everything right. So fill your hearts with Christmas cheer, cause Santa Claus comes tonight. Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. He'll come around when chimes ring out that it's Christmas morn again. Peace on earth will come to all if we just...
2021 was another challenging year with continued facilities closures, pivoting from virtual to in-person programs and introducing new and revamped programming to keep our Santa Fe Springs community and our employees safe. In May of 2021, the city reopened its facilities to the public. Throughout the entire year, our city staff continued to work diligently to offer essential services to keep our residents and to help our residents cope with the effects of the pandemic. We want to thank our city council for their ongoing support and leadership. And lastly, we want to thank our amazing Santa Fe Springs community for their resilience, their support, and for their patience during this pandemic. Here's a video recapping this year, 2021 in Santa Fe Springs. And then I just have one last item. Wanted to just share some of our community services programming. We've modified, suspended, and or postponed some of our programming through the end of February because of the current COVID surge. Some of these programs include our library remains open to the public with reduced hours Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. and on Saturdays from 12 noon to 5 p.m. The number of patrons that have been visiting the library over the last 3 weeks has dropped significantly. This schedule is going to be in effect through the end of February. Older adult services, they continue to offer classes in the senior center with reduced participation. Our caseworkers continue to assist and accept drop-off documents, and they're assisting our community via phone, email, and virtual. And also the Gusolasco food pantry continues to be open to the residents who are in need. The residents needing any assistance can contact our caseworkers at the Gusolasco Neighborhood Center. All our community service facilities remain open to the public. Our recreation in-person contract classes have been postponed and will resume in February. Our teen club meal program is still being offered at the Town Center Hall. Our ball field reservations are going to resume in March when the fields open. Facility reservations are going on as scheduled. Attendees must wear face masks while not actively eating or drinking. And then lastly, our President's Day Penny Carnival will transition to a virtual format with grab and go and distance experiences. Given the surge with the number of cases in LA County and the inability to predict the case numbers or the hospitalizations in February, combined with the recent amount of exposures among our staff and the large number of staff that's required to operate this program, and the amount of sharing of equipment that's required also for this program, we felt that it was best to move the event in this direction. And that concludes my reports. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maricela. And Madam Mayor, that ends our executive team reports. Thank you.
Thank you so much for all those all that great information. So now we'll move on to our council comments. We'll start off with Council Member Mora.
Okay, well, here we are back on Zoom one more time. But that's okay, we'll get stuff done. First of all, I wanna thank our planning department, our consultants, MIG, and also all those who spoke today, but also our apologies to those that were not able to voice their opinion and give their thoughts at this time. But we are gonna come together, we're gonna work, we're gonna have a very productive dialogue and get to a point where we can resolve this matter. I know the businesses alike, their concern is also, for our residents, but, we want to make sure that, we come to a resolution for this. So thank you all for doing that. Also, I want to make a quick comment on, on our police. And then I think maybe Ray, you may be able to kind of tag in a little bit later, but Wendy and I have been out with the Whittier Police ad hoc for quite a while. We went from a yearly meeting to meeting quarterly. And, the dialogue that we have with our police department, is incredible. One thing that they did bring up is, we know that our George Gascon, our attorney, whatever he is, he's not prosecuting misdemeanors. But, they hinted at maybe looking into, us prosecuting our own misdemeanors with the help of our city attorneys. So, that's something that, I think we should look into and hopefully mitigate, some of the crime that we're experiencing here in our own city.
Councilmember Mora?
Yes.
If this is something that interests the entire council or majority of you, city attorney, Is there something they can just give me direction at this point to look further in that if we have three of them wanting to do that or consensus?
They can give direction if they want to see it on a future agenda.
I'd like to see that.
I'm okay with it, Joy and Joe.
Most definitely, please.
Yes, most definitely.
Okay.
Yes, thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so and then also city staff, Maricela, great video, you know, quick recap of our year. And we got so many things to look forward to this coming year. But of course, you know, our COVID cases are up, so we all have to be safe. And, you know, we just got to, you know, keep it going. And Chief Hayward, I know that you're the firefighters, they're so close, the brotherhood that they have and sisterhood that they have with each other. You know, I know that it's a loss to, you know, to the entire force, but it's always felt. And I know that, you know, I spoke to you earlier and, you know, he was, you know, this one hit pretty close to home. I did see the tribute as the fire engine was moving with a hearse through the freeway. The tribute that our department did, it was very, very moving. It was beautiful. And I was glad that our city was there, you know, on the overhead bridge, you know, as they paid tribute to our firefighter. So with that said, good night, everybody. Stay safe and have a good night.
Thank you very much. And next, can we have Councilmember Sarno?
Yes, thank you. First, I want to say, you know, thank you to our HR department, Travis, Debbie, the overwhelming calls and cases that they are having right now. And it's very hard for an HR department to do their day-to-day operations, let alone have something like this come out and just overwhelm them completely. So I really want to thank our HR department for doing a fantastic job of letting us know the information that's going out in positive cases and who might be and who might not be. So thank you guys. The general plan, you know, we really need to get this together. This is an important document, like they've all stated, but it's important for our residents as well as our business community, because without the business community, there is no Santa Fe Springs. And that is the truth. So we need to make sure that we are compromising all of our beliefs and coming together as one. So with that, I hope we can get more study sessions, more dialogue of questions and answers rather than just presentations. So hopefully we'll get there in the next 2 weeks before the deadline. So I appreciate everybody's effort to try to come out and give us as much information as possible. Thank you guys. Have a good night.
Thank you, Jay. And next is Councilmember Trujillo.
Thank you. Just like John Morris said, with the Whittier PD contract, we've been doing it for some time now. We have such a good relationship with them. We're now to four times a year, and it's been an honor to serve with you, John. Aviv and Captain also. Thank you so much for letting me be part of that Whittier PD board. It's been really good. It's the relationship that we've had and what we've developed is awesome. Even though I'm not on that committee, I will still be here supporting you guys. Like I've always said, we're a team here and we will still be there supporting you guys. I'm going to miss those meetings, but we will do good and hopefully we'll continue and do something for having our own, doing our own stuff with our attorney, our city attorney, and prosecuting. Also, thank you so much for Siaka. I've been on that for 13 years and everyone knows how attached I was to that. So good luck with that, Duane. It's pretty fun. Just want to say thank you to Siaka. That was, like I said, it was my little baby, but it's, you'll have fun there with all the animals too. What else? Just this whole COVID, we're back to doing Zoom again, and it's, first, you know, we get excited. We're going to go back into the offices and be there. And now we're back to Zoom again. But hopefully we'll get it under control. And again, kudos to HR. They're handling it so well with so many different cases all over. And keep up the good work. And that's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Juanita. And now can we have our Mayor Pro Tem Zamora?
I just want to let, as you can see, I'm sick right now. So sorry about that. But I do want to thank just our staff and our business community. I mean, just the fact that you guys are making the efforts to come together. And I know that we do have to find a happy medium between all of us. So hopefully, you know, we do have to get these meetings set in motion. And I do agree with the council member Sarno that the quicker, the better. The more meetings that we have to do with each other, the better off we are. So we do only have about 2 weeks to go. So whatever we need to do, staff and our business community, let's get that going. Other than that, I just want to thank our staff and our community just for the efforts that they put in at the Norwalk site. Just to let you guys know, the Norwalk Mega site, Norwalk Santa Fe Springs Metrolink site, they've actually administered 18,000 tests in 7 days. So if you guys were wondering, so they did 18,000. So it's a site that is actually a forefront in a lot of areas. So they're actually getting city managers coming from all different areas to come check it out. So other than that, you guys take care and God bless.
Thank you, Joe Angel. And now, like our Mayor John Mora used to say, you have said it all, but I would really like to thank also our HR department chiming in on what Jay Sarno said. You already have your work to do each day, and the COVID takes a lot of your time and efforts, and it pushes you back because you have to continue to do your work. And being an HR manager, I know the feeling. We got hit hard too at the company, and I see it every day in our emails about our city staff getting COVID, and I feel for everybody, but you know, we just have to keep pushing, and we'll get through this. I had one of our residents, actually a registered nurse, call me today and told me that if our residents go on covidtest.gov, you can get 4 COVID tests mailed to your home. So, and, you know, just you can help other people. You can, if somebody needs it, you can help your neighbor. So it's called covidtest.gov. And actually, I went online and I ordered it, and it was very simple. So I wanted to thank that resident for helping. I'd like to also thank our Parks and Rec for the Christmas float. I've heard so many residents say how thankful they are to have this float in our community. And our volunteers that went out there every night, my husband and I were able to be Santa Claus and Mrs. Claus. And it's a lot because you're out there. All of our council was out there. I wanted to thank all of them as well. I saw you, and it was an amazing experience. Even our Mayor Pro Tem Zamora did TikTok. He was dancing. It was so cute. But it's a lot of work too behind the scenes. You know, it looks beautiful and everything, but what about behind the scenes? Our staff does all that work. And being out there for 4.5 hours, our staff is out there every night. So just think about that. I'm out there one night and I'm exhausted. They're out there every night doing that stuff. So I would really like to give them a big shout out and say thank you for all your hard work. And also, I would like to thank our staff for the beautiful reorganization on January 4th. I know it takes a lot of planning. I've done a lot of planning at my company, putting events together with the Women's Club, with all these other organizations that I'm involved in. So I know that planning takes a lot of work, and you, all of our staff and everybody who attended, you made John, Joe Angel, and myself feel very special and appreciated. So I just wanted to thank everybody that was there to say congratulations and wish us all the luck, because we want to move forward and we want to do the best job possible that we can. And we want all of our council to work together as a team. And, I know that our committees, you know, I know that some of you have been on committees for a long time, but, you know, I just thought maybe we can rotate and make, give everybody an opportunity to learn something new. And that's how we grow, you know, when we all give each other a chance to grow in different avenues. So I want to thank you for being so kind and letting me work that committee schedule out. And also, we want to work with everybody to move our city forward and to keep Santa Fe Springs thriving. Chief Hayward, I want to say just God bless Jonathan Flagler. I saw that on the news. It's tragic, and I just want to express from the council to the Flagler family our prayers and condolences to his family. And just Happy New Year to everybody. Let's keep moving forward. Let's be positive. Let's send out positive vibes every day and just be the best that we can be. And have a great evening. Thank you. And I forgot I'm supposed to close it. So hold on one second.
Madam Mayor, we do have a closed session.
Yes. Okay. Okay, so I would like to call upon the city attorney to read the closed session items.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the council. We have item 19, conference with labor negotiators, government code section 54957.6, agency designated representatives, Raymond R. Cruz, Travis Hickey, employee organizations, Santa Fe Springs City Employee Association, Santa Fe Springs Firefighters Association, and Santa Fe Springs Executive Management and Confidential Employee Association. We also had listed on the agenda item 20, conference with legal counsel. That one will not be held.
Okay, and we will now recess to closed session. We will reconvene the meeting after closed session to hear any report from closed session and to adjourn the meeting. Thank you. See you at the next meeting.
Do we have a quorum yet?
We do, but we're missing Annette.
Yeah, we're just waiting for Annette. There she is.
Sorry about that. Okay, I'm here.
We have a quorum, Madam Mayor.
Okay, I would like to reconvene the meeting. City Attorney, is there a closed session report?
Thank you, Madam Mayor, members of the council. Direction was given to staff and no reportable action was taken.
Thank you. I would like to adjourn the meeting. Thank you, everybody. I think we're done here.
Thank you.
Have a nice evening.
Good night.
Good evening.
Bye. Bye.